It's a pleasure for me to introduce a guest speaker who is an old friend, but more than that. But Jack is the technology futurist. For over 20 years, he has provided expert guidance and best practices to such Fortune 500 companies as GE, Coca-Cola, ESPN, Morgan Stanley, and CVS, as well as providing advisory services to such leading technology solution providers as Microsoft, IBM, SAP, and Oracle. Mr. Shaw graduated from Yale and has a master's degree from Northwestern University. He is widely recognized for his expertise in such leading-edge technologies as mobile commerce, social media, decision management, and cloud computing. He's an industry thought leader and the author of three critically acclaimed books and numerous white papers, the founder and publisher of both EDI Executive Newsletter and the E-Commerce Buyer's Guide. He's delivered lectures to more than 1,000 audiences in more than 20 countries. The advisory services of the firms Jack founded, E-Commerce Strategies and Breakthrough Technologies, have saved schools, universities, and other public and private sector organizations billions of dollars over the last 25 years by leveraging technologies which have enabled them to implement more efficient processes and deliver improved results. His keen perception and vision into emerging technologies and their applications have also enabled technology solution providers to build products and services that anticipate where the market is headed and meet the changing needs of both private and public sector organizations. As you will see, Jack is uniquely talented at translating technology into understandable terminology. Would you help me please in welcoming Mr. Jack Shaw? I guess you might say, as far as introductions are concerned, this was probably the most recent.
Thank you, Dr. Truby.
Yes, thanks, Jack.
When it comes to the impact of technology on education, the list of cultural and technology trends that are impacting educators and students is so long that we don't even have time to read through the whole list today. But what I thought might be instructive is to see some comments about emerging educational technologies, just to put things into perspective a little bit first. Before I share these comments with you, would everybody please stand up for a moment? Would you raise either your left or right hand in the air and say out loud, "Hey there!"
Hey there!
Okay, you can sit back down now. So when I ask you a question, we don't have to worry about anybody who can't interact because you're incapable of either standing, raising your hand, or speaking. And when I do ask you this, don't even bother to stand and raise your hand. Just shout out an answer. So first of all, you saw a long list, and you're certainly, as professional educators, familiar with many educational technologies. So what technology do you think was being addressed by this person who said, opening new doors for teaching science? What emerging educational technology is this writer referring to? Anybody? Pardon? Virtual field trips. Virtual field trips. What else? Come on, anybody?
Video conferencing.
Well, let me give you a hint. This particular quote was made in 1965. Now, who wants to make a guess? What? Louder.
Calculators.
No, they weren't around yet in 1965. I'm old enough to know. Hard computer, somebody said, somebody else? What they were referring to was a powerful technological breakthrough called the overhead projector. All right, here's a quote. Today, the world of the learner is almost unbounded. They must acquire facts relating to a bewildering variety of places and things. They must acquire appreciation of far-reaching interrelationships. The curriculum and methods of teaching must undergo a continuous appraisal. New subject matter and new devices for instruction are being scrutinized for their potential contribution to the learning process. What new technology is this writer referring to? Louder?
Internet.
The internet. That's a good possibility, but wrong. What else?
Radio.
Radio. Get it closer, because the year was 1933. Now, radio wasn't quite correct, but take another guess.
Television.
Pardon?
Television.
No, television wasn't quite here yet. Movies, or as they called it, the talking picture. So, and for those of you who graduated from college after 1995, we're not talking about the things that hang on the wall in the Harry Potter books. We're talking about what they actually used to refer to movies as being. Now, we do have, of course, the social media revolution. And that is one of the things that is having a profound impact on our entire world, not just education. In fact, it was interesting this morning, I heard a news piece that was mentioning that Goldman Sachs has invested in Facebook, and the market value of Facebook stock is now estimated to be $50 billion, which is more than Yahoo, eBay, and several other major players in the market. But let's take a little bit of a look at what's going on with the social media revolution. That's good. That's might be good. And this certainly shows you something about the explosive growth of emerging technologies. Focusing on, it's a little hard to read, but it says the U.S. Department of Education study revealed that online students outperformed those receiving face-to-face instruction. So clearly, it is time for change. And as educators, it's not going to be enough for you to be willing simply to accept change that's imposed upon you. It's really not even enough to embrace the changes that you have opportunities to interact with. If you're going to be successful in the long run, you've got to actively seek out opportunities to change. What can we do better and differently? And part of that is how can we use technology more effectively to help our students learn, to teach our students, to assess their progress, and to increase the productivity of the school system as a whole. Who can tell me what this acronym stands for? No takers? All right, then we need to talk about this. Pedagogical knowledge. This is the knowledge that you all, most all of you, have been trained in terms of your education, and certainly that those of you who have been teaching for some time have acquired in terms of on-the-job expertise. It's about how to teach more effectively. So if you have strong pedagogical knowledge, that's something that's necessary. How do you convey the concepts to your students? If you've got those capabilities, is that all you need to teach successfully? Louder?
No.
What else do you need? Exactly, content knowledge. You need to be able, you need to know what you're teaching about. So content knowledge is equally important. You've got to have a thorough grounding in the subject matter, command of the subject, or more explicitly, knowledge of the concepts, theories, and conceptual frameworks, as well as knowledge about accepted ways of developing knowledge. But even if you have content knowledge, and you have pedagogical knowledge, how to teach, that's still not going to be enough unless you can really integrate those two effectively. Do you have knowledge about how to combine pedagogy and content effectively to make a subject, a particular subject, understandable to learners? What makes a given subject easy or difficult to learn? And what kinds of misconceptions or preconceptions are students likely to be bringing with them into a course with a given type of content? So understanding the right tools and techniques for conveying content, depending on what the nature of that content is key to you. In the 21st century, clearly, teachers have to have pedagogical content knowledge. If you have that, do you have all the tools you need to be fully successful as a teacher in the 21st century? No. What else do you need? I'd suggest that you also need to have technology knowledge. And that means not just be digitally literate yourself in terms of understanding how to use the tools, but understanding how to apply those tools in a technology-enhanced learning environment. Now, that includes technological content knowledge. How do you use technologies to teach various different kinds of content? For example, digital animation could make it much easier for students to conceptualize, for example, how electrons are shared in chemical bonds when chemical compounds are formed. That's an example of applying a technological tool to help you convey a certain type of content. That same technological tool might not be appropriate for a different subject, and yet there might be a different technological tool that is appropriate. You've also got to have, or at least understand how to leverage, technological, pedagogical content. That means understanding the capabilities and limitations of various technologies as enablers of different teaching approaches. So an example of that would be online collaboration tools that might facilitate social interaction and team teaching capabilities or team learning capabilities on the parts of the students when they are geographically separated. So there's a variety of technologies that can be better or less effectively used for various different kinds of teaching approaches. Altogether, you've got to put the whole thing together, and this is what TPAC is: technological, pedagogical, and content knowledge. Successful educators in the 21st century understand the interplay between content knowledge, pedagogical knowledge, and technical knowledge, and will leverage those to address their understanding of the complex relationships among learners, teachers, the content, practices, and technologies. These are some of the things that you need to think about. Now, it's also important to understand how rapidly some of these technologies are evolving. And I was delighted to hear somebody bring up the concept of virtual field trips. I think that's a terrific idea. How many people have been on Second Life? Let me see your hands if you've been in Second Life. All right, those of you who haven't yet, log on to Second Life and go to EdTech, E-D-T-E-C-H, EdTech Island, and check it out. And if you don't know what Social Life is, ask your teenager, Second Life is, I mean, ask your teenager or one of your students. So what does the future of education hold for us? What is likely to be different? Well, I think it's helpful to understand just how powerful some of these technologies are. So I'd like to share an example with you from outside of the education area, just to give you an understanding of how powerful these technologies are. And then I'll show you a couple of examples of these technologies being applied in the in education. Do we have any auto racing fans here? Anyone? Yeah? Okay, a few of you? Good. So when you ask people, what is the most remarkable automobile race in the world, you'll get different answers from different people. Some will say, oh, it's the Indianapolis 500. Others will say, oh, no, it's got to be the 24 hours of Le Mans. But it's clear to a lot of people in the South that it could only be NASCAR. And these are all remarkable races. But I'd like to suggest that perhaps the most amazing automobile race that ever took place was the Desert Challenge. Over 300 kilometers across some of the most challenging terrain in the world, in the desert, outside of Las Vegas, Nevada. The winner of the Desert Challenge was named Stanley, and here we see a photo of Stanley. Anybody notice anything interesting about this automobile? Louder?
No driver.
No driver. This was not a remote-controlled automobile, though. The reason it had no driver was because this automobile functioned autonomously. It navigated itself over 300 kilometers of unmarked desert terrain. But I could tell you about it all day long. Let's go to race day. Here we see Stanley pulling out of its starting point. It was a staggered start, taking a swing over in front of its admiring fans before then heading out into the desert. Now, nobody knows when exactly the first person driving an automobile passed another person driving an automobile, but we do know with unmanned automobiles, because this was it, Stanley swinging around another vehicle, actually using a laser guidance system to determine that it needs to move to the left, leaving a clear space of about 1 meter for safety purposes between Stanley and the other vehicle that was passing before it then headed out into the desert. One of the most challenging parts of this entire race was a section referred to as Beer Bottle Pass. And here's Stanley entering Beer Bottle Pass about 200 kilometers through the race. Very tricky because off to the left, you can see up ahead, there's a ravine. And if the vehicle, keep in mind, there's nobody steering this car. It's navigating itself with a combination of GPS laser guidance and video camera navigation. If it makes the wrong turn at this point, it's hundreds of feet down into the ravine. And yet of the 20 vehicles that started the race, the five that made it this far completed the race. Here we see him coming up to the checkered flag, which the fellow is waving as if that means anything to the car. Finally, we see, and through the upper right-hand corner, you can see the view from inside of Stanley as it's approaching the final finish line and stopping in front of the stands. It completed this entire race in 7 hours, averaging over 25 miles an hour, as I said, over unpaved desert. There were times when the chase trucks, which were there simply for safety purposes, to disable them if they should go completely off course, and never had to do that. The times when the chase trucks that were driven by people had trouble keeping up with those automobiles. Now, the point I'm trying to make here is that while the visual technologies of determining where the automobile was are impressive, the GPS, the laser guidance system, and so forth, what's really powerful is the intelligent decision-making capabilities built into the software, determining what does this mean, where are we, is our plan working the way that we intended it to? Do we need to adjust the plan, whether it's steering slightly differently or finding a new route around an obstacle in order to get where it is that we're trying to go based on the input we're getting? When you start thinking about making plans, getting continuous input, and of revising the plan as necessary during the process so that you get the desired outcome, does that sound like anything that teachers do? Exactly. And the technology tools that are beginning to emerge out there, I wish I had time to show more of them to you than we will today. Today can be very powerful tools to do that. Now, when you look at this kind of incredible technology, and you think about how technologies have evolved over the last 10, 20, 50 years, on the one hand, it just seems absolutely amazing that something like that should be possible. And at the other hand, you kind of realize it's inevitable. It's what we can refer to as an inevitable surprise. Now, the English teachers in here will immediately recognize inevitable surprise as what appears to be an oxymoron, right? But the scientists teachers might actually be more kind of tuned into the concept, if not the terminology, because we do encounter inevitable surprises from time to time. And those of you who are into science might have noticed the download that just came in this past weekend from the Mars rover that's still functioning up there, aptly named Opportunity. I don't know if you saw this picture or not, but it's the inevitable surprise. Well, okay, so these tools, and by the way, these slides will be posted to your website, and some of these links will be active so that you can go check these out yourself. Go to the National Educational Technology Plan, and you can see a host of educational technologies for learning, assessment, teaching, and productivity. A couple that I want to take a quick look at, one called Co-Writer, and let me give you a quick, real quick product demonstration of that.
Writing fluently with Co-Writer is as easy as 1, 2, 3. You simply think it, try it, and choose it. Let's try it out. Think it. Think about what you want to say. Try it. Write it down. Use words that you know but have trouble spelling. Choose it. Choose the word from the list when you have trouble with the word spelling. It's that easy. You will notice that Co-Writer will help you write words that you have trouble spelling. This makes it really easy to write what you think because you don't have to limit yourself to the words you can spell.
So that's one good example. Now, that seems simple, right? What could be simpler than something that's... But think about the sophistication of the intelligence and the technology that lies behind immediately providing students with a list of potential words that it appears that they're trying to spell. And that kind of intelligent technology is very powerful. Similarly, in the assessment area, there's one called Bookalike that you find very interesting. I think you'll find very interesting. So, for example, suppose you have a student that was very excited about having finished reading Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows, the last book in the series. Well, you can look in Bookalike and find a whole series of other books that that student might enjoy that are at approximately the same level. For example, Brisinger from Christopher Pacini's Inheritance trilogy and a variety of others, or Aragon, that are at approximately the same level. Or if you say, you know, this is good, but we want to give this student something a little more advanced. What's available that is, say, 2 years more advanced than that particular student? Now we're looking for books that, instead of being at the seventh grade level, are at the ninth grade level. And that comes up, and now we see things such as Kidnapped by Robert Louis Stevenson, or biographies of Abraham Lincoln or Frederick Douglass. Similarly, you can go back and say, yeah, the student is not ready for something quite that advanced, but we want to give them something that's 3 years earlier, and now we have student books at the fourth grade level, like The Lightning Thief from Percy Jackson and the Olympians, and books like that. Now, a very experienced and highly knowledgeable teacher is going to be able to do some of that on her or his own, but to have a tool like this, again, that will automatically give you hundreds of selections to consider is beneficial, certainly, for both teacher and student. So what this means is that you need to make a change in the underlying educational philosophy about what constitutes basic skills. It's not just about the 3 R's anymore. It's about learning to learn and lifelong learning and learning with your students. The computer-based materials that are available are just one key component of the resources that you need to draw on. And it's integrating technology into those content areas that becomes one of the real challenges and opportunities for successful teachers as you move ahead. Teachers are never going away. There's a role for online learning, there's a role for automated learning, but it's the definition of the learning environment and how classrooms function is going to be changing, and so must the models of effective instruction. You have to move away from the old traditional model of the sage on the stage or even the guide on the side. Think instead of becoming the vet in the net. That is, the participating learner who is knowledgeable, experienced, understands the tools, is willing to learn along with the students, and is the veteran who's going to mentor the students on moving ahead and finding the answers, leveraging the tools and technologies that are available. To make these changes is important because we need to continue to make progress. And as the famed historian Henry Steele Commager put it so well, change does not necessarily assure progress, but progress implacably requires change. So let me encourage you to change, refine, and extend your capabilities in leveraging technology as an enabler to help you do an even better job of helping your students learn and succeed in school as you move ahead in 2011. Thank you for listening.
You've been presented with many thoughts, ideas, challenges, perspectives, and I think that's the way we want to approach our position here, whatever our positions might be in Lamar County right now, to think about the future, remind ourselves that we are holders of the future in our hands with what we do and who we do it with. So let's keep those things in mind. And Jack, I want you to know we hope to have you back sometime down the road and follow up on this with us. We appreciate it very much.